Hello and welcome and namaskar. Today at Bookmark, we propose to discuss about five landmark judgments of a retired judge, former Justice of Supreme Court of India, Honorable Sri Justice Krishna Iyer. In the galaxy of legal luminaries in India, Justice Krishna Iyer shines and stands apart like the sun. Justice Krishna Iyer is known for his opulent and affluent style of writing. He has authored some real soul-stirring judgments. His judgments have left an indelible mark in the annals of Indian legal history. Apart from the scholastic and juristic content, his beautiful rendition of words casts a spell on the readers. Justice Iyer is known for having discussed various subjects cutting across a wide spectrum, and Justice Iyer's judgments are a treat to read. Rich in vocabulary, embellished with fine and crisp literary connotations, Justice Iyer's judgments invoke a sense of delightfulness in every connoisseur of law. Today, at Bookmark, we propose to revisit five such landmark judgments of Justice Krishna Iyer that won just cannot afford to miss. And before we start our discussion, let me remind you that these judgments are not selected by an expert panel, or we haven't conducted any survey or opinion poll. These are simply handpicked by me as per my choice, as per my academic orientation. So let's start our discussion. The first judgment that we have marked in the five must-read judgments of Justice Krishna Iyer is the Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board versus A. Rajappa. Now, let me remind you, in the whole judgment of Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board versus Rajappa, you won't get to read the facts of the case. But to make it more simple, the judgment is all about the discussion of the word industry. There's an enactment, a legislation called Industrial Disputes Act. The preamble of the Industrial Disputes Act says that it is an act for investigation and settlement of industrial dispute. Now, there is a whole machinery carved out in the Industrial Disputes Act for settlement of the disputes, and primarily the act focuses that the disputes between employer and employee, the workers and the management, instead of going to courts, they need to be settled at the first level itself by interference at the hands of the settlement machinery, that is the conciliation officer and so on and so forth. That apart, this judgment, that is the number one judgment that Justice Krishna Iyer delivered, is Bangalore Water Supply Sewerage Board versus Rajappa, is based on the definition of the term industry that appears in Section 2J of the Industrial Disputes Act. Now, as I said at the outset, the facts of the case are not clear in the whole body of the judgment. Then what is the judgment all about? The judgment is about what had happened prior to the Rajappa case, that the Honorable Supreme Court, a five judges judgment, which was led by Justice Hidayatullah in the Safdarjung Hospital case, had interpreted the term industry with a very restricted meaning. Hospitals were not considered to be industry, so a staff member working at hospitals couldn't approach the industrial or labor court seeking resolution of his disputes. Now, the whole issue was thereafter reconsidered by the Honorable Supreme Court in this judgment, that is Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board versus Rajappa. Justice Iyer in the judgment has given a very wide and liberal interpretation of the term industry. And I may tell you that hospitals are considered to be industry, pinjar poles are considered to be industry, temples are considered to be industry, and so on and so forth. So a wide meaning to the word industry has been given by Justice Iyer in Bangalore Water Supply versus Rajappa case. Now, at the very beginning of the judgment, It is a 7 judges judgment. Justice Iyer's judgment starts from para 25. He opens up the judgment with these words: the rather zigzag course of landmark cases and the tangled web of judicial thought have perplexed one branch of industrial law, resulting from obfuscation of the basic concept of industry under the Industrial Disputes Act. Justice Iyer at para 26 further goes to say, legalese and logomachy have the genius to inject mystique into common words, alienating the laity in effect from the rule of law. What is the common worker or ordinary employer to do if he is bewildered by a definitional dilemma and is unsure whether his enterprise, say a hospital, a university, a library, a service club, a local body, a research institute, a pinger pole, a chamber of commerce, a Gandhi ashram is an industry at all? Natural meaning is nervous of acceptance in court, where the meaning of meanings is lost in uncertain erudition, and cases have even cancelled each other out while reading meaning. So this is Bangalore Water Supply Sewerage Board, Justice Krishna Iyer in his inimitable way. Then we move on. The second judgment is Motiram and others versus State of Madhya Pradesh. Now, Motiram and others versus State of Madhya Pradesh, I have these few notes with me. What were the facts of the case? The facts of the case were such that a man who was convicted for some offense had filed an appeal before the Honorable Supreme Court against his conviction. The appeal was admitted by the Supreme Court and bail was granted by the Supreme Court to that accused, that is Motiram. While granting bail, the Supreme Court, instead of putting the conditions, had said that the accused shall furnish his bail to the satisfaction of the magistrate court. Now, this magistrate court was the court where he was originally convicted and he was supposed to furnish bail there. Now, at that time, when the bail was to be furnished by this Motiram before the magistrate court had put a condition that the magistrate directed the petitioner to furnish a surety, and it was in sum of rupees 10,000. And a condition was also put that the person standing surety had to be of the same district where the petitioner resided. Now, unable to furnish bail because the amount was huge, that is sum of rupees 10,000. In addition to that, the condition which was found to be atrocious by the appellant, that is Motiram, that the surety, the person who has to stand surety, has to be of the same district and could not be of the other district. Now, with these difficulties, Motiram again took his grievance to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court then, Justice Krishna Iyer, framed three questions. What were the three questions? Now, the three questions where I'm reading those out: can the court under CRPC enlarge on its own, enlarge a person on his own bond without sureties, a person undergoing incarceration for a non-bailable offense, either as a under trial or as convict who has appealed or sought special leave? So can a person be released on bail on his own surety? That was the first question. The second was, if the court decides to grant bail with sureties, what criteria should guide it in quantifying the amount of bail? So whether the financial condition of the person has to be looked into, what are the criteria for grant of bail while quantifying the amount? Then third is it within the power of the court to reject the surety because he or his estate is situated in a different district or state? So these were the three questions that the Supreme Court Justice Krishna Iyer had formulated. Now, this judgment is a wonderful piece of literature. What Justice Iyer has observed, I'll read out the para. It is, if a Mason and millionaire were treated alike, egregious, inequality is an inevitability. Likewise, geographic allergy at the judicial level makes mockery of equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. India is one and not a conglomeration of districts untouchably apart. He further goes to say, Constitution enacted by we the people of India is meant for all. It cannot make any difference between the butcher and the baker and the candlestick maker. And shall we add the bonded labor and pavement dweller? So this was Motiram. Now let's move to the third judgment, and that is Raj Kapoor versus Laxman. The facts in Raj Kapoor versus Laxman were such that a film produced and directed by Raj Kapoor titled Satyam Shivam Sundaram had released. This was somewhere around 1985 or 84. The film was certified to be an adult film by the Board of Film Certification, that is the Censor Board. Now the Censor Board, as per Section 5A of the Cinematograph Act, is empowered to grant certificates to the films. We all know that. Despite the film being certified as A, that is adult, this Laxman, a citizen who was residing in the state of Himachal Pradesh, assailed the film before the magistrate court. A prosecution under Section 292, that is offense of obscenity, was lodged against Mr. Raj Kapoor, the famous director and the producer of the film. Witnesses were examined and the magistrate took cognizance of the prosecution under 292. A notice was issued to Mr. Raj Kapoor. Based on that notice, Mr. Raj Kapoor appeared, but he felt that he needs to challenge the prosecution before the Honorable High Court of Himachal Pradesh, and therefore a quashing petition under 482 of the CRPC was filed before the High Court. The High Court dismissed and ultimately the matter went to Supreme Court. Now here the Supreme Court has taken a recourse to another provision from the Indian Penal Code, that is Section 79. Now this 79 comes under the chapter of general exceptions for those viewers who are not related to law. Section 79 is a general exception, which means that there are a few exceptions carved out, almost 20 in the Indian Penal Code. I may be subject to correction in regard to the number of exceptions. So 79 is one of the general exceptions. General exceptions means that some offense has occurred, but the law will ignore it because it is carved out as an exception. Now what 79 of the Indian Penal Code says is that nothing is an offense which a person does, and that activity or that act is justified by law for that person to do. Now the argument in Raj Kapoor versus Laxman by Mr. Kapoor before the Supreme Court was that once he has obtained a certificate from the certification body, that is the Censor Board, then he is justified by law to exhibit the film, and therefore merely because somebody feels that the content in the film is obscene, that cannot be an offense. So in Raj Kapoor versus Laxman, Justice Krishna Iyer quashed the proceedings against Mr. Raj Kapoor, and what he has said at para 10 is something again inimitable in his style. He says, and the board, alive to its public duty, shall not play to the gallery, nor shall it restrain aesthetic expression and progressive art through obsolete norms and grandma inhibition when the world is wheeling forward to glimpse the beauty of creation in its myriad manifestations and liberal horizons. A happy balance has to be maintained. Now, I found this to be a very unique term that Justice Iyer has coined in order to indicate to some orthodox school of thought, some retrograde people who feel that this is wrong, that is wrong, and they have objection to every new content that comes their way in regard to entertainment and cinema. But Justice Iyer has described it as grandma inhibition. So Dadi Nani, he is referring to that category of people who will feel that everything that comes across under the name of entertainment is obnoxious. So let us move further. This was the judgment, Raj Kapoor versus Laxman. The fourth judgment that we have to discuss is Jolly George, Varghese and another versus the Bank of Cochin. In Jolly George, Varghese, the facts were such that from the Bank of Cochin, this Jolly George, Varghese, who was a borrower, had borrowed a loan of sum of rupees 2.5 lakh. He couldn't repay that. The account went in default category and ultimately the bank moved the local court for recovery of that sum of rupees 2.5 lakh. In addition to that, the penal interest, whatever had accrued by then. So the bank succeeded in the recovery proceedings, and for the knowledge of the viewers who are again not related to law, a separate execution has to be filed under Order 21, which is a separate chapter under the Code of Civil Procedure, for the actual recovery of the amount. So such recovery proceeding was filed by the bank against Mr. Jolly John Varghese. And in that recovery proceeding, the execution court, that is the court which was now supposed to execute that judgment of recovery, the execution court attached the property of the borrower, and a court receiver was appointed to just look after the attached property. Despite this, now, maybe because the amount was high than what could be recovered from the attached property, or for whatever reason, the bank then moved for arrest and civil detention of Mr. Jolly John Varghese. Now, there is a separate provision under the Code of Civil Procedure for arrest and detention, and that is Order 21, Rule 37. So, by way of Order 21, Rule 37, Mr. Jolly John Varghese's custody was sought for by the bank, and then the executing court granted such custody. Against that order of the executing court, Jolly John Varghese approached the Supreme Court, and Justice Iyer, again, by referring to some international covenants and agreements, and also referring to Article 21, in his very humane, kind, gentle, affectionate way, said that it's not that a person cannot be arrested at all. There can be an arrest and civil detention in case of non-payment of loan dues, but then in that case, to proceed with the arrest, the court will have to first verify as to whether the person is deliberately avoiding to pay. The refusal has to be deliberate and intentional. Now, without verifying that is the credentials of the borrower, that is in this case, Mr. Jolly John Varghese, the court, the executing court had ordered his arrest and detention. So the Honorable Supreme Court, Justice Krishna Iyer, remanded the matter back to the executing court and directed the court to first verify as to whether the refusal on the part of the borrower was deliberate and intentional. So the recovery court was to, the executing court was to verify that. Now, in the course of this judgment, again at para 10, I'm reading out that para, Justice Krishna Iyer says, it is too obvious to need elaboration that to cast a person in prison because his party and consequent inability to meet his contractual liability is appalling. To be poor in this land of Daridri Narayan, that is land of poverty, is no crime, and to recover debts by the procedure of putting one in prison is too flagrantly violative of Article 21. Unless there is proof of the minimal fairness of his willful failure to pay in spite of his sufficient means and absence of more terribly pressing claims on his means, such as medical bills to treat cancer or other grave illness. So this was Justice Krishna Iyer in Jolly John Varghese. He further goes to say, unreasonableness and unfairness in such a procedure is inferable from Article 11 of the Covenant, but this is precisely the interpretation we have put on the proviso to Section 51 of Code of Civil Procedure, and the lethal blow of Article 21 cannot strike down the provision as now interpreted. Now, the fifth judgment that we have to conclude our discussion with is Gopalanchari versus State of Kerala. Recently, while conducting a case before the Honorable High Court, I have come across this judgment. Now, this judgment is in regard to chapter proceedings under Section 110 of the Criminal Procedure Code for taking preventive measures and in order to protect the citizens and maintain public peace in cases where the police comes across such persons who are habitual offenders. They can restrain such person by conducting a mini trial. The whole procedure is given separately in the chapter in Criminal Procedure Code. Now, 110, Section 110 of the Code of Criminal Procedure empowers the magistrate to detain persons who are habitual offenders. Now, in Gopalanchari, what had happened is this man, Mr. Gopalanchari, was of 71 years of age. He was arrested and detained by the police on the allegations that there are some four cases of theft which against him were pending adjudication, and the court had not concluded that he was guilty. No conviction, no sentence was passed. The trial was underway. Despite the police officers arrested Mr. Gopalanchari and asked him to furnish surety and bail, which he could not furnish. Now, in such cases, the bail and surety has to be furnished with the police officers. He couldn't furnish the surety, and for two years, he was languishing in the jail at Kerala. So Mr. Gopalanchari wrote a letter to Justice Krishna Iyer personally and put up his grievance before the Supreme Court. Now, the issue before the Supreme Court was who is to be considered as habitual. Merely because there are allegations of some four offenses against a person of which the trial is yet to be conducted, can he be termed as habitual? Because we must know that law will consider a person to be innocent until he is proven to be guilty. With that analogy, Justice Krishna Iyer has said something very important in regard to who can be termed as an habitual offender. And while elaborating that, Justice Iyer goes on to say, and I am reading out that para, expressions like by habit, habitual, desperate, dangerous, hazardous in Section 110 cannot be flung in the face of a man proceeded against under Section 110 with laxity of semantics. The court must insist on specificity of facts and be satisfied that one swallow does not make a summer, and consistent course of conduct convincing enough to draw the rigorous inference that by confirmed habit, which is second nature, the counter petitioner is sure to commit offenses mentioned if he is not kept captive. He further goes on to say, preventive sections privative of freedom, if incautiously proved by indolent judicial processes, may do deeper injury. They will have the effect of detention of one who has not been held guilty of a crime and carry with it the judicial imprimatur to boot, and so on and so forth. So this was the fifth judgment by Honorable Justice Krishna Iyer. What do I say? These judgments have always touched me, have resonated in my minds the way the thoughts of Sant Tukaram have resonated in the minds of people from Maharashtra, the way thoughts of William Shakespeare have resonated in the minds of people who are connoisseurs of English language. Justice Krishna Iyer is such a towering figure that he has become immortal in the annals of Indian legal history with his immortal judgments, which he has penned with such passion and such dedication and devotion. A person who will always remain immortal in the minds of Indians, every Indian citizen, and lawyers, of course. This was Justice Krishna Iyer and his five landmark judgments. Thank you.